This is a portrait of Desiderius Erasmus of Rotterdam, made by Hans Holbein in 1523 and hanging at the National Gallery in London. The Erasmus University Rotterdam was named after the humanist, author of The Praise of Folly from 1511, who believed in education to improve human capacities.
Welcome, Ario. Hi. So you have just recently published a book on the value-based economy. Can you please tell us a little bit about how this can be relevant to explain and understand perhaps the work of museums?
I have, for the last 25 years, focused on the study of the world of arts and culture, and among which also museums. The insight that I gained from studying the world of arts and culture is that when you look through the lenses also of artists, people running museums, the world looks a little bit different than when you look at it from the lenses of a standard economist. If you look at it through the lenses of standard economists, you think an organization, a museum, who operates in a market, selling tickets, presenting exhibitions, of course, finding out that there are market failure, not enough people willing to pay to cover the cost. So you need a government to step in to help with the financing and to make ends meet, so to say. And then we can think also at the management of museums, the costs of running expositions, maintaining a collection. And so there are economists like Bruno Fay, who says, well, listen, if the roof is leaking, as was actually the case in Prado, and you have these incredible possessions that you are never able to exhibit anyway, why not sell off some of these artworks, the accessioning, that's called. Now, that's a taboo in the museum world, and then economists say, well, why is that a taboo? Why wouldn't be able to buy and sell and run the museum like any economic enterprise? Well, the value-based approach is to show that a museum is not like a cookie factory, it is not a standard economic enterprise. And it has a lot to do with how we conceptualize it. And that's what we learned actually from studying the arts, that we need different concepts. In the approach of a value-based approach, you emphasize that museums are about values, things that are important. And a museum has a purpose that is not profit maximization, but it's like maintaining parts of civilization to contribute to, say, what we could say, the cultural qualities of a town or a country. But maybe it's also to bring people together, to give them a common story, or to inspire people, to help making sense of their life in some way, as what art can do, or all the other objects that museums collect. So the first thing to do when you study museums is to look at that. What's the purpose of the museum? What does the museum contribute? The second question to answer is to also understand, and that's often overlooked, but to understand what a museum enables the visitors to realize, to sort of, for at least during that visit, to look at the works, to understand why they are there, what it means to see this history, and to make sense in some way. I think the sense-making activity is critical for a museum. What do you buy when you go to a museum and buy a ticket? Now, most people say an experience. Think again. All what you buy is actually a ticket, and that gives you access. You can spend all the time in the museum that you want. You can go to the bathroom, you can go to the cafeteria, not look at the art or the objects, right? That is what you have a right to do when you buy a ticket. At 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock, when the museum closes, you are having to leave. So you don't buy art, you don't buy the experience. That is critical, that you only can realize by, and this is the critical word for me, to contribute something. A visitor, a museum, has to contribute something, like making an effort, trying to make sense of what is there, to see the art in it, to compare, to do the work. To do mental work, emotional work, to grasp. So every visitor contributes in some way or another. If you think about it that way, then you also understand that a museum is not just satisfied having visitors and counting, oh, then we got a million visitors, great. But you really want to also know what these visitors are doing with their experience and actually are willing to contribute, because that's the purpose, in the sense that they start talking about it, thinking about it, that what they have seen plays a role somehow in their life. That's what you want as a museum. So first you think about the values of the museum, you think about the values of the visitors, and then you understand that what happens in a museum enables so both the museum as the visitors to realize their values. Then you come to the next critical term, it becomes like a co-creation. It's not that the museum does the work and the visitors consume, no. They both have to do the work. See, many people think that a museum is like a public good, right? That it represents something that has to be accessible, no one has to be excluded. I think that in this approach, you start to think not in terms of a public good, but more like a common good. And what's the difference is that a public good, like a forest or the air, you just enjoy. Right, you can just go out there and enjoy the public good that is a forest or an air. That's not true with a museum. You have to make an effort. You have to participate. You have to contribute. And then it's more like what we also say in creative commons. If you understand that people have to participate and contribute, then it becomes really different from a cookie factory, right? And because that you can consume, you can eat and enjoy. With a museum, it's just different. You have to participate and you contribute. Now, if that's so, and then the perspective already changes, because then you understand it's not just the market, people buying and selling things. No, it's also what I call a social sphere where people participate and contribute, much like in many other activities.
Could you tell us a little bit about what a manager in a museum should consider from this value-based economy approach?
When you run a museum, you have to be very careful always about the willingness of people to contribute. It's very tempting because of also financial reasons, management reasons, to do all kinds of things that discourage people to contribute, because it becomes too commercial, or it becomes the more like a museum shop than that it has an exposition. Have you had several cases like the World Museum here in Rotterdam became actually more a restaurant than a museum. And so, yeah, it was good for the business. And indeed, the restaurant generated a lot of revenue to cover the cost of the museum. But that's not what the museum is about. And it didn't invite the contributions that a museum needs. So we call that purpose drift. Or crowding out. These concepts we have, crowding out, purpose drift, that you crowd out the important values. So managers have to be very careful. And I think also managers should also be focused on this willingness to contribute. That comes to the next point, the financing. It is indeed, you finance it by selling tickets, and you can also finance by getting public subsidies, and you can get sponsors. All legitimate ways to finance a museum. But if you understand the importance of the willingness to contribute, you also look for other sources of finance. And that is, as is the case in many countries, especially United Kingdom and United States, that you're also seeking people who become members, donate, become part of the museum. That becomes a truly communal effort. And the commons is also commonly owned by all kinds of individuals. That's in a way the ideal, not always realizable in a country like the Netherlands, where people are not willing to contribute also financially to that extent. But that is an ideal to strive for. If you say that the museum has a purpose that it wants to realize, that it wants to enable its visitors to realize things that are important to them, the real key then, I think, in the museum world is to have ways to evaluate that. Because if you cannot evaluate it, you can claim whatever you want. You can suggest whatever you want. And people in the world of the arts are very good at that. But in the end, it's not going to convince the supporters, the financiers, the governments that is the case.
Can you tell us a little bit about how you see the value of museums in a digital world?
We see that new technologies are going to make a difference in the way we communicate, the way we distribute. That's interesting. That affects all kinds of other activities, also in the arts world. And so I think that the form may change, that the way people also are able now to access and also get in some way much richer access to the artworks as through digital media. It doesn't change the principles. And the principles, in a value-based sense, is to continue thinking, what's the purpose? What are we aiming for? And what is it in that what we are accomplishing in terms of that people contribute, participate, and that we have true conversations about the things that make that are important to us, that contribute to our sense making. So I am always interested in new methods only if it contributes something to the intensifying of the conversation, as I say. So the challenge will be in a world that will be in some way become larger to contain it in such a way that it remains significant. That to me is a big challenge with this new media. We see it all over the place. And the danger also that then bubbles are shaped and then people feel actually more excluded than before. So I don't think that that digital techniques are a solution. They have possibilities, but also threats. Yeah, so the key is that a museum keeps, with whatever technological environment you operate, keep focus on what its purpose is, and that is to contribute something culturally, socially, to whatever society group it considers to be important. Some museums have large ambitions, some museums are smaller, that all varies, but that's where it starts with. To imagine and to be clear about what people are able to realize it, and to understand that you create an environment where people can contribute and participate. And I like the metaphor of a conversation, that a conversation takes place. And so if I go to a museum, I feel part of a conversation. This doesn't mean that I talk about it all the time, but I really feel that I can share the meanings with others. And so this painting or this object is more than just an object. It's a shared object, we say. It's a cultural object.
So is it that you argue in your value-based economy that the more valuable institutions are those able to actually engage their visitors so that together in this engagement with the multiple constituents, arguably also their policymakers and other fellow museum institutions, then together they will be able to be part of these commons that increase each other's value.
That's right.
Thank you, Arjo, so much for sharing some of your views on the value-based economy. And we hope to see you soon.